Good morning, all of you. I am Dr. E. Srinivasa, working as an assistant professor of physics in IDSG Government College, Chikmagalur. In this video, I am going to explain some concept of nuclear detectors, that is a scintillation detector or counter, which is a syllabus for 3rd BSc physics students studying in 6M corresponds to paper 8. The name of the paper is Nuclear and Particle Physics. And this is the video for session number 10. So what are scintillation counters or detectors? In this video, I am going to explain the construction, principle and working of scintillation counters along with photomultiplier tube. Scintillation counters or detectors are multi-purpose particle detectors used for charged particle detection as well as neutral particle detection also. Charged particles may be positive or negative ions, that means protons, neutrons and alpha particles, neutral particles or photons and also neutrons. That means scintillation counters can be used to detect charged particles as well as neutral particles also. And this counter uses the principle of excitation effect of incident radiation. That means whenever a radiation incident on some materials, the electrons get excited to the high energy state and then de-excited to the ground state. So this counter uses the principle of excitation effect of incident radiation on a scintillating material. This is important, scintillating material, and detecting the resultant of light pulses. Scintillation counters are multi-purpose particle detectors used in many experimental physics applications also. This is one of the oldest and most useful techniques for the detection and spectroscopy of a wide range of radiations. Construction. So this scintillation detector consists of scintillators. This is the scintillator, maybe ZNS or anthracene, any scintillation material, and also photocathode. This is the photocathode, and so assembly of the dynodes, that is a photomultiplier tube, PMT, photomultiplier tube consists of a photocathode and an assembly of dynodes to accelerate the and multiply the number of photoelectrons which are produced by this scintillation of light in the photoelectric effect. So there are dynodes in the photomultiplier tubes, and also CRO cathode ray oscilloscope to analyze the pulsate and measure the counts, and a capacitor, and also high tension batteries which is connected to the dynodes. This is the construction of the scintillation detector. And this is the enlarged diagram of the scintillation counter or detector, in which high energy photon or any high energy radiation incident on this scintillator produces an ionization and also excitation. So these are the ionization tracks, and also there is a photocathode. This photocathode converts the light energy into electrons, and there is a focusing electrode, and also there is a photomultiplier tube consists of cathode and anode, and a series of dynodes which are maintained at different potentials or higher potentials. So this is the primary electrons, secondary electrons, etc. This is the anode, and this output pulse is connected to electronic circuit assembly, consists of CRO and also electrical circuit. Scintillator is kept in front of photomultiplier tube. The photomultiplier tube consists of photocathode and diodes D1, D2, D3, etc. Photocathode C is earthed. The diodes are given a positive voltages. So you all know that scintillation counter works upon the principle that when high energy radiation falls on fluorescent material, produces a flash of light called scintillation. So whenever high energy radiation falls on the fluorescent materials like zinc sulfide, produces a flash of light called scintillation. The material that can exhibit this phenomena is called scintillators. So the main part of a scintillation counter are shown in the block diagram. In the last, you are know, I think you are seen about that block diagram of the scintillation counter in the last slide. So you already know that scintillation detector works on the principle of excitation effect of incident radiation on a scintillating material and detecting the resultant light pulse. So what is excitation? We all know about that. When ionizing radiations like alpha, beta or gamma ray, photons, even neutrons fall on the scintillator, they lose energy to excite or ionize the atoms of the phosphor. When the atoms returns to the ground state, photons are emitted in the blue and ultraviolet region of the optical spectrum. So whenever we supply an energy to the atom, electrons move from a low energy state to an excited state. This process is called excitation. So the position of the electron in the energy state, excited state, is unstable within the short interval of time. So the electron comes to the ground state. This process is called de-excitation. During this process, it emits the absorbed energy. So that this is the flash of light, light energy produced in the scintillator are called scintillations. Thus, the scintillator converts the energy of the ionizing radiation into flashes of light or scintillations. The number of such protons is in proportional to the amount of energy deposited by the ionizing particle. The number of photons is proportional to the amount of energy deposited by the ionizing particle. The phosphor is optically coupled with the envelope of photomultiplier tube. Some portion of these low energy photons arrive at the photocathode of an attached photomultiplier tube. The photocathode emits at most one electron for each arriving photon by the photoelectric effect. That means the photocathode converts light photon or light energy into photoelectron. This is called photoelectric effect. As you know that photoelectric effect is the phenomenon in which whenever a high energy electromagnetic radiation incident on the photosensitive material, it liberates photoelectrons. So here also the same principle applicable. The photocathode emits at most one electron for each arriving photon. If one photon comes, that photocathode converts one photon into one electron by the photoelectric effect. This group of primary electrons is electrostatically accelerated. That means by applying high potential difference and focused by an electrical potential so that they strike the first diode of the tube. The impact of a single electron on the diode releases a number of secondary electrons which are in turn accelerated to strike the second dynode, which maintained at higher potential compared to the first dynode. Each subsequent dynode impact releases further electrons, and so there is a current amplifying effect at each dynode stage taking place. That means these dynodes multiply single electron into 4 to 8 electrons, and at each dynode maintained at higher potential, multiplication of the photoelectrons taking place. Each stage is at higher potential than the previous to provide the accelerating field. The resultant output signal at the anode is in the form of measurable pulse. The resultant output signal at the anode, finally at the anode, is in the form of measurable pulse for each group of photons that arrived at the photocathode and is passed to the processing electrons. That final measurable pulse is passed to the processing electrons. The output pulse from the photomultiplier tube is fed to a pulse amplifier followed by a scalar and counter unit. In order to remove the undesired low energy pulses, a discriminator circuit is introduced between the amplifier and the counter. Power to the various stages is supplied from a stabilized power supply. So at various stages, so for the dynodes, so the power is supplied by the stabilized power supply. The pulse carries information about the energy of the original incident radiation on the scintillator. That final pulse carries information about the energy of the original incident radiation on the scintillator, and also the number of such pulses per unit time, that is count rate, gives information about the intensity of the radiation. That means intensity of the radiation is directly proportional to pulses per unit time or count rate. In some applications, individual pulses are not counted, but rather only the average current at the anode is used as a measure of radiation intensity. So this is the complete setup of the working of a scintillation counter. So this is the scintillator. So in which there is an incident particle through window produces a flashes of light in the scintillator. They are called scintillations, and this optical contact, there is a light guard, and also there is a photocathode. This photocathode converts the light photon into electron, that is photoelectron. Here this is the flash of light. That flash of light is converted by the photocathode into a photoelectron. So this photoelectron is made to incident and focused on the dynode 1, D1, which is maintained at some higher potential. This photodiode multiplies a single electron into more electrons, like 4 to 6 or 8 electrons. And again, these electrons are accelerated by the second electrons are accelerated by another dynode. This dynode also multiplies the number of photoelectrons which are coming from the first dynode, and the photoelectrons which are multiplied by the second dynode are again multiplied by the third dynode, so on. Finally, so we get a measurable output pulse at the anode. These are all in the photomultiplier tube, and there is a high voltage divide and pulse amplifiers are there. High voltage source is there to apply a constant power supply to the dynodes. And also there is a pulse discriminator, digital counter, multi-channel analyzer, etc. And finally, so the counts are counted and stored in the data storage system. This animation pictures how the incident radiation in coming into the scintillator and produces a scintillations. That scintillation is converted into photon, and that photon is made to incident on the dynodes. These dynodes multiply the photoelectrons, and finally the multiplied photoelectrons are passed through the load resistance, produces an output voltage or output pulse across the load resistance. And also here the dynodes are connected by different resistors to produce a different high voltage, which is connected to the high tension battery, that is negative and positive. Next, we will study the important component of the scintillation counter, that is photomultiplier tube. Photomultiplier tube is the most important component of the whole arrangement. We shall describe in detail. So, photomultiplier tube is an integral part of the scintillation detector. Having scintillation photons is not enough to detect. It is very essential to convert them into an electrical signal. That means that photomultiplier tube converts the low energy scintillation light into an electrical signal. A schematic diagram of photomultiplier tube is as shown in this diagram. So we will study in detail about the photomultiplier tube. So here again, high energy particle or photon so is incident on the scintillator. This is the scintillator. This scintillator converts high energy photon or particle into a flashes of light called scintillations. These scintillations are converted to the photoelectron by the photocathode, and these photoelectrons are made to incident on the assembly of dynodes, which are maintained at different positive potential, because these photoelectrons are negatively charged particles. They are accelerated and multiplied by the positive potentials. A single photoelectron is converted into four to six in electrons. Again, this dynode, multiplication of the photoelectrons takes place by this dynode. Finally, a large number of photoelectrons are produced. And again, so there is a pulse output connected to the counting device. So this arrangement involves a vacuum. And also in this cylinder, a vacuum is created, and all these assembly is called photomultiplier tube. The photocathode is important component of the photomultiplier tube, which is very close to the scintillation crystal, and it converts scintillation photon into photoelectrons, as I already explained. It is made of a very thin layer of photoemissive material. In photomultiplier tube, the photoemissive materials used are usually like metal alloys that have extra electrons. The released scintillation photons will strike the photocathode and causes it to emit electrons that are released into the vacuum space of the photomultiplier tube itself. The emitted electrons are directed towards the first dynode, by providing the proper electric field to the focusing grid. A series of dynodes multiply the small number of generated electrons at the photocathode. The dynodes are made of materials like BeO, MgO, CH3Sb, etc. I mean beryllium oxide, magnesium oxide, cesium, antimony, and are maintained at positive electric potential, each one higher than the last. They are curved or positioned so as to direct the emitted electrons towards the next dynode. The electrons released at each dynode are accelerated towards the next dynode again because of the potential applied between the dynodes. The process is continued for 9 to 12 dynodes for a total multiplication factor of about millions. I mean, one single photoelectron is converted into millions of photoelectrons, which gives rise to a small but measurable electrical signals. Finally, the anode collects all the electrons produced from the last dynode and emits output voltage signal. Finally, the anode collects all the electrons produced from the last dynode and emits output voltage signal. The high voltage supply of photomultiplier tube determines the potential difference between the dynodes and therefore the final size of the photomultiplier tube output pulse. Scintillation detectors are very sensitive to changes in high voltage. Therefore, the high voltage supply must be steady and well regulated. The output signal of the photomultiplier tube anode is very small. Therefore, the strength is boosted by using preamplifier. The amplifier then amplifies the preamplifier output signal by a variable amount. The multiplication factors in the amplifier are typically between 1 and 100 and are adjusted via the energy multiplication knob on the electronic module. The amplifier also shapes the pulse and shortens it to provide a series of discrete pulses. What are the scintillation counter properties? They are fast time response. That means light generated almost immediately after particle passes through the scintillator. Photo detector gives fast electric signal. Can count number of particles using pulse height. If the pulse height is large, then the count rate is large. The larger the signal size, the greater the number of particles. And also they gave position information based on size of active scintillator material. So these are the scintillation counter properties. Superiority of scintillation counter or detector over GM counter and also proportion counter. Scintillation counters have a high efficiency of detection and also short resolving time and linear response over a wide range of energy of incident radiation. They can detect wide range energy of incident radiation. Due to these advantages, scintillation counters are considered to superior to GM counter. Because of its extremely short duration pulse and high resolution, the scintillation counter is far superior to a proportional counter also. Then what are the applications of the scintillation counter? Scintillation counters are used to measure radiation in a variety of applications, including handheld radiation survey meters, personal and environmental monitoring for radioactive contamination, medical imaging, radiometric assay, nuclear security, and nuclear plant safety. The second application is there are several counters of mounted on helicopters and some pickup trucks for rapid response in case of a security situation due to radioactive waste or dirty bombs. Scintillation counters designed for weight bridge applications, freight terminals, scrap metal yards, border security, contamination monitoring of nuclear waste and ports. It is also as its application in protein interaction and detection, academic research and pharmaceutical research also. Liquid scintillation counters is a type of scintillation counter that is used for measuring the beta emission from the nucleides. So I have used all these books as reference to make this video and PPT. Thank you for watching. Thank you once again.